Welcome back, students. Hello to everyone. Please subscribe and like the channel. And today's topic will be the further in flowering plants reproduction. We are talking about pollination now. Pollination, what do you mean by pollination? It is the transfer of pollen grains from anther of one flower, it could be a same flower or different flower, to the stigma of same flower or different flower. So pollination overall can be the transfer of pollen grains from anther to stigma of a flower. Now pollination, it is of two types, self-pollination and cross-pollination. Self-pollination, as the name indicates, self means among itself only. So, self-pollination may, there are two types, autogamy and gytnogamy. Autogamy is the case when the flower is same. That is, we have a same flower in case of autogamy, which means that anther and stigma, they both are present on the same flower. While in gytnogamy, the flowers are different. The flowers are like the stigma of one flower and the stamen of another flower. Now, autogamy has various methods of self-pollination. How the self-pollination takes place? Autogamy, the methods can be, number one, homogamy. Homogamy means maturation time is same, like the anther and the stigma, they are maturing at the same time. So when the maturation time is same, they are going to have self-pollination 100%. Whereas the another method is cleistogamy and chasmogamy. Cleistogamy in case of closed flowers, because cleistogamous flowers are also called closed flowers. So when the flower is closed, jab flower band hoga, to anther and stigma will be inside the flower and 100% surety of self-pollination. While chasmogamy or the chasmogamous flowers are open flowers. But again, we can relate this chasmogamy to homogamy, which means maturation time of both stigma and stamen is same. So anthers and stigma will mature at the same time, but the flowers are open, and cleistogamy, the flowers are closed. So this comes under the two methods which we have under autogamy. And gytnogamy, as the name indicate, it is the self-pollination between the flowers, the male flower and female flower born on the same plant. When we talk of cross-pollination, it is totally a different process. Why? Because cross-pollination requires different species and different plants. The anther of one flower and stigma of another flower of different plant, not the same plant. So transfer of pollen grains from anther of, suppose, plant A to plant B, the stigma of plant B, anther of A will give the pollen grains to stigma of B, means two different plants are involved. This is called xenogamy or allogamy, which means cross-pollination. I hope this topic is clear to you. Now moving ahead, we have a very important topic which comes along, the advantages of self-pollination. Why do we say self-pollination is advantageous? Because there are certain points. Number one, see, very less chances of failure of pollination. That means the pollination is 100% sure. Pollination will never fail. Never or very less chances. Number two, purity of race is maintained. When we say purity of race is maintained, then imagine a mango which we used to eat in our previous years, that ripe, tasty and sweet smelling mango. If the mango is, suppose, being pollinated by self-pollination every time, the quality is maintained. That quality will be only maintained because the purity of race is maintained. The same race is going to continue for many years. But if we have any changes in it by the cross-pollination, then the variety goes either down or the variety may have different taste also. So, the purity of race should be maintained, which is only under self-pollination. Now, the flowers are not required to be large and showy. In self-pollination, the flowers, they can be small. The flowers, they cannot, like they, it is not necessary that they should be large, they should be attractive, but they can be small, they can be simple. And in fact, no nectar is required to be produced. So the energy of the plant remains minimum. The energy which is required to produce these characters goes down. And because of this, the plant has more energy for the other processes. Okay. So advantages of self-pollination. But there are certain disadvantages also. For example, it produces a weaker progeny. Why the progeny becomes weak? Progeny means what? Progeny means offsprings. Why the progeny becomes weak? Because every time the same parent is producing more and more, more and more and more. So the offsprings which are developing now from the same parent is becoming weaker. And resistance to the diseases decreases. Means if a parent plant is carrying some disease, those diseases are continuously spread throughout among the offsprings because there is no external character which may provide resistance. So resistance to diseases decreases. Now coming ahead, we have advantages of cross-pollination. Cross-pollination, it produces individual with new desired characters. Means the individuals which are going to be produced by cross-pollination will be very developed because they are having our desired characters which we want in them. Number two, offsprings which are produced are healthier and are of better yield. Means the yield, which is the production, will be high, it will be better and will be producing good seeds. This property is also called hybrid vigor. Hybrid vigor is most of the time asked in exams. What is hybrid vigor? When the offspring, due to cross-pollination or due to introduction of some other method, produces good varieties or healthier seeds or better yield, means superiority. In crops. This is called hybrid vigor. And the next point is disease resistant crops are produced. Because cross-pollination is there, we can have a desired character in it, so the diseases can be removed easily. Disease resistant crops or varieties are produced. Now, there are some disadvantages of cross-pollination as well. See, it is uncertain. Cross-pollination is uncertain. Why we call it uncertain? Because there is always a factor of chance which is involved. will the pollination occur? Will it not occur? It depends upon the agent. Because cross-pollination always waits for the agent to come across. If the agent is not there, the pollination will not take place. So it is uncertain. It may produce some undesirable characters also by chance, like some mutations may occur, some undesirable characters may be included in the plant. So cross-pollination will be having a troublesome characters also at times. Next, coming up, there is a general question which is asked most of the time. What are the adaptations that ensure cross-pollination? Or this question may be asked through another mode also. What features or characteristics avoid self-pollination? What do you mean by this first part? It is ensuring cross-pollination. How can we have 100% cross-pollination in a plant? And the same, the question is in another form, it is being asked, how can we avoid self-pollination in plants? So the question will have a similar answer, the one and only single answer, which will go like this. There are certain characteristics which the plant should have. They are asking for the adaptations, no? So adaptations or characteristics the plant should have for ensuring cross-pollination and avoiding self-pollination. Number one is unisexuality, which is also called declining. Unisexuality means single sex. For example, unisexuality may, you will have a single male flower and a single female flower. So the plants can be based on that. Monoecious plants. What are monoecious plants? When both male and female flowers on same plant, they are produced. So it is monoecious. But are we looking for monoecious plants? We are looking for monoecious plants, but the flowers can be different. The flowers, like the male flowers, can be on the same plant, but the flower is different. And female flower is different, but it is on the same plant. So it becomes different flowers, but same plant. So different flowers are there. So 100% it is a unisexuality. Dioecious plants, when separate plants, male and female flowers are born. So plants will be different, flowers also will be different. So in this case, the papaya is there. And in monoecious plants, the pumpkin was there. Second point is dichogamy. Dichogamy means what? Anther and stigma mature at different times. When anther and stigma will have different time of maturation, then 100% cross-pollination will be favored. For example, anther matures first. When anther matures first, it is called protandry. Protandry, pro means first. So protandry in case of when anthers are maturing first. So example, salvia, ladyfinger, etc. But protgyny, when stigmas are maturing first. So example is peepal and banyan. So in this case, 100% cross-pollination is favored. Next comes heterostyly. Heterostyly. Flowers have different heights of stamen and styles. When a flower is having different height of stamen and a different height of style, then easily the self-pollination may be avoided. Because for self-pollination, the height of stamen and style should be same. For example, jasmine and oxalis. Oxalis in Hindi you call it rye. So jasmine and oxalis are the plants which have different heights for stamen and style. Next is harcogamy. Harcogamy, when stigma and anthers mature at the same time, but there are always some barriers. Maturation time of stigma and anther is same, but there are always some barriers, and due to these barriers, the self-pollination is avoided and cross-pollination can be favored. For example, a flap covers stigma. Suppose in case of pansy flower, stigma is always covered with a flap. Suppose this is a stigma and it is always covered with a flap. So if this flap is covering a stigma, so it will not have self-pollination. Suppose anthers are here, they cannot drop down their pollen grains. So a flap, when it covers stigma in case of pansy, it avoids self-pollination. Another, corolla forms pockets. Sometimes corolla is collection of petals. Corolla forms pockets to close anthers. So anthers are being closed inside those pockets which are formed by corolla. So when anthers are closed, so it will not favor self-pollination. Third point, in orchids, the pollen grains are enclosed in pollinia. Pollinia is a form of a kit which is formed by anther. Means the pollen grains, they are going to be covered or enclosed in a pocket-like thing which is called pollinia. And these pollinias can only be opened by the insects. So it will be transferred only by the insects. Until and unless insects comes, the pollen grains will not be shedded. So it 100% ensures cross-pollination. And similarly in salvia also, salvia may liver mechanism operates. Now what is liver mechanism, I am going to show you later on. Because salvia we have another in insect pollinated flowers, we are going to show you. Liver mechanism may, the pollen grains are only shed at the back of insect visiting for the nectar. Suppose any insect which visits salvia for the nectar, at the back of that insect the pollen grains will be shed, and due to this those pollen grains will not be given for self-pollination. It will be only cross-pollination there. Now a very important topic that comes forward is characteristics of different flowers. Like what are the flowers? Anemophilous flowers. Anemophilous flowers are called wind pollinated flowers. Hydrophilous flowers are called water pollinated flowers. Entomophilous flowers are called insect pollinated flowers. So first of all we are going to take anemophilous flowers. Means the flowers which are pollinated by wind. Anemophilous flowers, what are the characteristics? How do the flowers look like? Flowers are colorless. They are without nectar, small and without fragrance. Flowers are colorless, without nectar, small, without fragrance. The pollen grains are produced in large numbers. Pollen grains are light, dry and sometimes feathery. Stigma is broad, sticky, well exposed, so that when the pollen grains which comes in large number can easily be stick to the stigma. And the examples are wheat, maize, bamboo and sugarcane. So these are some characteristics of anemophilous flowers. The flowers which are pollinated by wind. hydrophilous flowers. These flowers are small, without bright color, and they have unwettable perianth. What do you mean by perianth? Perianth is when sepals and petals cannot be distinguished among themselves. Means sepals and petals, they look alike. They are same. So perianth is no differentiation between these two. So I'm saying hydrophilus, these flowers are small, without bright color. They have unwettable, jo geela nahi hota hai, unwettable perianth. Pollen grains protected by mucilaginous cover. Mucilaginous cover means a cover made up of mucus. Mucilaginous cover, and the pollen grains, they have long, pollen grains are having a mucilaginous cover, and they have, these flowers have long and sticky stigma. Stigma is long and sticky. So when stigma goes long, anther will not be able to drop the pollen grains on these stigmas. Example is Wallisneria. Wallisneria is a water pollinated flower. Water, it is totally submerged in water, and it is dioecious. Dioecious, I have already told you, when the flowers are born on different plants. So we have male flower and female flower on different plants. Male flowers are small in Wallisneria and short stalked, means the stem is short, and they are short stalked. Female flowers, they are born on long stalks. Long stalks pe female flowers are born. Now in this, what happens? The male flowers, first read this and then I'm going to show you how does it takes place. The male flowers float on water. Female flowers rises up to the surface of water. Both comes in contact. Male flowers burst, giving out pollens. And after pollination, female flowers long stalk curls up, moving down to the bottom of sea. Now let's see the diagram first. Now this is the diagram, see. What happens in Wallisneria? I told you, these are the male flowers which are born in large numbers. Male flowers, they are very small. Okay. Now this is a plant which is carrying a female flower. Now, female flowers are this one. These male flowers are going to come in contact and lie down in this depression of female flower. Suppose this is a female flower. This one is a female flower. Now, can you see these small male flowers roaming around? These small female flowers will come and lie in this depression. This is known as stigma. When these male flowers will come here, they will burst and they will drop their pollen grains into it. And these pollen grains will go down till the ovary. So this is how the pollination as well as fertilization takes place in case of Wallisneria. Okay, so next is entomophilus. What are the entomophilus flowers? The flowers which are large, brightly colored, full of nectar. They are showy, attractive. Why they are attractive? Because they have to attract the agents, that is the insects. So entomophilus flowers, once again, the flowers are large, brightly colored. They are full of nectar, showy, attractive, and the pollen grains are covered with a yellowish sticky substance which we call pollen kit. So when a question comes, what is pollen kit, you will always say, in entomophilus flowers, there is a yellowish sticky substance which covers the pollen grain. This is called pollen kit. Why it is present? Because it sticks to the legs of insects and they can be easily transferred from one place to another. Now, entomophilous flowers are mostly nocturnal. What do you mean by nocturnal? The ones which will only bloom at night. So, the flowers which will bloom at night, jo raat mein khilte hain, these flowers are sweet smelling. And these flowers, they will have insects coming to them. When insects will reach them, then the pollination will be carried out as they will carry all the pollen. Now, this is the example of salvia. Now, what happens in salvia? Salvia is a flower. If you see here, this is the stigma, style, and it leads to the ovary down. Now, the petal of this flower up. Here, we have anther. This is a fertile anther lobe. Why we call it fertile? Because the pollen grains are going to be given by this. The pollen grains are going to be shed by this anther. And this one is a sterile one, which will not give out any pollen grains. This is the filament to the anther. And this is also inside, you can see a connective which will help out in bursting to give out the pollen grains from the anther. Now, this is a flower, salvia. Now, as soon as the insect reaches salvia, the upper lip of corolla, which I have already shown you, this one, this is the corolla, the upper lip, this is the fertile anther. At the lower lip, when the insect is sitting, the fertile anther has just moved down due to the liver mechanism. And this fertile anther lobe is going to dust all the pollen grains on the back of the insect. How does it happen? The insect strikes here. When it strikes here, the anther lobe comes down and it gives out all the pollen grains on its back. So, this is a case of salvia, which is insect pollinated flower. Another very important example is yucca. Now, in yucca, what happens? Now, in yucca, this is a flower. If you see here, yucca is a flower which is pollinated by Pranuba, the moth called Pranuba. Now, what happens? Pranuba and yucca, they share mutual relationship or symbiotic relationship, because yucca cannot be pollinated by Pranuba, and as the moth cannot complete its life cycle without yucca. So, they both share equal relationship or mutual relationship, we can say. Now, when the female moth visits Pranuba visits yucca flower at night, it collects all the pollen grains in form of ball inside its mouth. And after collecting all the pollen grains, it pushes those pollen grains inside this passage. When it goes inside this passage, all the pollen grains, when they go down, then the pollination is carried out. And at the same time, the Pranuba lays all the eggs, and these eggs are being given inside this place. So, eggs get collected here. So, there is a place for Pranuba to lay eggs also, and Pranuba is helping out the flower in pollination. So this is a mutual relationship between Yucca and Pranuba moth.